So recently, I went out with my friends, and before leaving, I saw that on my phone the weather said smoke. And I thought, smoke? What kind of weather is that? And then I went outside and I saw. I mean, you were breathing in and you were actually breathing in smoke and dust, and you could feel it in your throat. You could feel the irritation. It was horrible. And we've always had smog, and for the last couple of years, I feel like the smog has increased. But this year, it's been so bad that, I mean, I myself was curious, like, why? Why does South Asia get so much smog as compared to the rest of the world? So when I started researching, I did not just want generic answers that we already know. I wanted research and data-based answers that if you're saying that this is the cause of pollution, then tell me, how do you know that? How much pollution does it cause? And that's exactly what I want to share with you guys today. Hi, my name is Misha, and welcome to Tarihi Tales. I know I usually do make historical content, but this time smog piqued my interest and I just had to look into it. So South Asia has officially surpassed China as the most polluted area a couple of years ago. According to the IQ Air Ratings in 2021, 43 out of the 50 most polluted cities in the world were located in Pakistan, India, or Bangladesh. So smog by this point in South Asia is an event that recurs every year. And its basic characteristics are high concentration of air pollution, low visibility, and of course, this then leads to a huge level of socioeconomic disruption in the region. And smog, to some degree, has always existed within this region for a lot of years now. But since 2016, this has become so intense and so severe that some people have started labeling this as the fifth season in South Asia, which is the smog season. And it's not like the entirety of South Asia is engulfed by this. It's a very specific region. This phenomenon is usually seen in the northwestern parts of the Indo-Gangetic Plains, which is this region that I'm showing you on the map. But to really understand as to why this specific region is so heavily struck by smog, we need to go into some details. And while doing research, obviously there was a lot of scientific small explanations and terminologies that I came across, and I had to look into them. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and give you guys a more simplified explanation of what's going on. If somebody does want all the scientific nitty-gritties, you're always welcome to go down into the description box and have a look at the researches that I used, and that can help you out. Now, this region, which falls into the Indo-Gangetic Plain, is actually a very, very fertile region. It is one of the oldest regions where civilization has existed. And because of that, this region is very fertile, has a lot of people, and that means a lot of farming and other human activities. It also means that there are a lot of tiny dust particles and pollution in the air. These tiny particles, known as aerosols, can kind of act like seeds, which cause the formation of clouds. When there's a lot of moisture in the air, these particles attract water vapors and kind of grow, forming larger clouds. But unfortunately, the pollution in the air also then kind of sticks to these clouds, making them a lot darker and dirtier. And these can lead to poor air quality and other environmental issues. And once these clouds are formed, there are two other phenomena that take place and kind of make sure that the smog lingers in this area and doesn't kind of go away with the wind or disperse. Firstly is the fact that after the monsoon season in the Indo-Gangetic Plains, we get something called stable meteorology, which basically means that there's a resistance of the atmosphere to vertical motion, meaning the winds don't go upwards and away like they usually would. And this phenomenon only takes place when a layer of warm air is kind of created over the cooler air, thus trapping the cool air and not allowing it to move. This is called a temperature inversion, and it stops the upward motion of air, which is the natural kind of motion and which usually would help dissipate and disperse this kind of pollution. So these dirty clouds basically tend to stay where they are. They can't just move away, and that's why the smog lingers so much in this region. Then, on top of that, there's another thing. That is the topography of the area, which means that the Indo-Gangetic Plain, if you look at it, it's surrounded by mountain ranges, the Hindu Kush, the Karakoram, the Himalayas. So all of these mountains kind of create this valley effect, which further reinforces this stable meteorology and makes sure that the air in this region doesn't easily go away, which becomes one of the major causes as to why the smog lingers in this region. It wouldn't be such a big issue if the wind would just blow like it usually does. So we understand that the wind basically gets stuck in these areas, right? But the question is that how does it get so polluted in the first place? What is going on? Now, one of the biggest reasons, and one of the reasons that I think a lot of us already know about, is the burning, the agricultural burning of stubble by farmers in both India and Pakistan. And this burning takes place on a very, very massive scale. Have a look at this graph. This figure shows data that was collected from 2015 to 2020. They recorded daily long-term average fire counts. This data is recorded by NASA through Moderate Resolution Imaging Spectroradiometer, which is called MODIS for short. In India, this study covered the region of Punjab and Haryana, and in Pakistan, this covered the region of Punjab and Sindh. You can see that in the graph, the mustard-colored lines are fires in Pakistan, and the blue ones are in India. Now, looking at the time periods of these fires, you can see that the timing of majority of the fires, agricultural fires, which are taking place in India, is closer to mid-October and November, which in turn is also the time that the smog kind of hits these regions. And it's quite interesting how NASA collects all this data. It's basically images from satellites which look like this, and you can see that the red dots, all of the red dots, are fires taking place live in agricultural areas. And then they use that and process it further to kind of get to where we are with the graph. Now the thing is, it's easy to say that, well, maybe we should stop the farmers from burning the crops. Or why are they burning the crops stubble? Well, experts point out that this is most likely due to the high levels of mechanized farming that now takes place in both of these regions, which results in the production of an ample amount of stubble, almost 15 centimeters high in some areas, which is very, very labor and cost intensive to remove by hand. And there's a time frame that these farmers have to work with, because immediately they need to get their field ready for the next crop. So they don't have the time or the money to be able to do all of this by hand. So the quickest way has always been to burn the stubble away, and hence preparing the field for the next crop, which needs to be planted at a very specific time. Otherwise, needless to say that if these things are kind of disrupted, then there would be other issues like food shortages, which again would be a humanitarian crisis. Having said that, that doesn't mean that there are no ways to combat this. There are, and maybe we'll get into that in some other video. But this practice has always been prevalent. According to estimates made by Gupta in 2012, 90% of the area harvested through combined harvesters in Punjab, Indian Punjab, burns away their stubble, which is a big percentage. This might have gone down in recent years due to government interventions in both the countries. So burning the stubble of the crop basically causes a lot of pollution and a lot of actual smoke, which then lingers. But the question is, how much pollution does it really cause? Do we have any data to see exactly how much? Well, yes, we do. Well, one of the metrics which is used to measure air quality is the aerosol PM2.5. This can greatly influence the air quality, the ozone layer, and the climate itself. Now, a part of the research done regarding the causes of smog kind of uses data from the US embassy stations located in Lahore, Delhi, Dhaka, and Kathmandu. This data is a time series of the daily averages of PM2.5 in the air in all of these different cities. And at the same time, the data also shows us the WHO recommended PM2.5 in the air, which you can see in this graph. Now, for all of these cities, you can see the timeline on the x-axis, and then the blue lines are the amount of PM2.5 in the air. The red line that you see is the WHO guideline for how much it should be. So, as you can see, for the majority of the year, the PM2.5 levels in our air are much more than the recommended amount. But if you get a closer look and you look at the months where there are certain sharp increases in all of the cities, you know, you can see it's following a pattern. All of those increases are right after the season where the burning of the crops takes place, which is also the post-monsoon season, where this phenomena of smog starts to occur. So you can see from the graph that the burning of the crops does heavily coincide with increased levels of pollution in the air. But we can't just blame the farmers and the burning of the crops for the pollution, because we have some more data. Have a look at this graph now. This graph shows the air quality index of various South Asian cities in the post-monsoon season and the rest of the year. Now, these cities again are Lahore, Delhi, Kathmandu, and Dhaka. You can see from the graph that even the rest of the year, the air quality that we have in all of these cities is almost at best unhealthy. And then when the post-monsoon season hits, then of course, in cities like Lahore and Delhi and Dhaka, things go up to hazardous and very unhealthy. So this graph kind of begs the question that, well, okay, if the burning of the crops causes the smog, then what about the rest of the year? Why is there so much pollution all year round? And the answer is, well, because there are a lot of other factors going into kind of increasing the overall levels of pollution. And according to researchers, like we just saw, especially in bigger cities like Lahore and Delhi, air quality remains poor throughout the year. And a major reason for that are anthropogenic emissions. This means that the emissions of greenhouse gases and aerosols due to human activities. And within this category, there are actually a number of reasons which play a part in ruining the air quality. Now, firstly, we have vehicular emissions, which means emissions by cars, buses, trains, bikes, etc. And these emissions have steeply increased over the years in both India and Pakistan. In the case of Pakistan, the number of registered vehicles in the country have increased almost 400% from the year 2006 to the year 2020. Then after the emissions from vehicles comes another kind of emission, which is the industrial emissions. And as we know, a lot of the cities like Lahore, Faisalabad, Multan, which face a lot of smog in Pakistan, they're all surrounded by industries as well, which again have a lot of emission. These emissions have also rapidly increased over the years. When you look at a time frame from 1970 to 2005 in Pakistan, the emissions of the gas CO2 have increased 1000%. And then the emission of nitrogen oxides, different type of nitrogen oxides, has increased for about 20%. And the effect of these emissions can be seen by other studies and other graphs like the one I'm showing you right now. This graph is showing you the aerosol optical depth in different cities. Now, just like you, I had no idea what aerosol optical depth is, and I looked into it. And it's a measurement of how much light is actually blocked by particles in the air from reaching the ground. The particles kind of indicate the level of pollutants in the air. And as you can see from the graph, the level of pollutants in the air is heavy all year round, pre-monsoon, in the monsoon, and then increases post-monsoon, and then again stays high. It's never really low, and this is a consistent trend throughout the different years. This graph is showing us from 2015 to 2020. So by now we figured out there are a number of reasons which kind of cause smog. Now within the same category, we also have things like power generation, the emissions that come from that, as well as the emissions that come from brick kilns. So another question I was interested in was, do all of these factors contribute equally to smog? Or is one of the factors much more bigger factor in the contribution than the others? And you may be wondering, why does it matter, right? Well, because if we know for sure that this specific reason is why the smog is so much, then the other reasons also contribute to smog, but on a smaller scale, then you can think about policies to kind of tackle the largest reason first so that there's a significant difference the next year round. And one of the researchers that I was looking into actually was interested in figuring this out. And to do that, they undertook an approach, an analytical hierarchy process, which was kind of conducted to understand which of these factors that we've talked about above are the most contributing factors towards smog. Now there's an entire, the research paper I've provided below gives you an entire detail of how they figure out these contributions. So if somebody's really interested, you can go and have a look there. But here, I'm gonna talk about the results that they get. And according to the data, the transboundary pollution, which is occurring due to the burning of crop stubble in the Indian Punjab area during that specific time period that I showed you earlier on in the video, is one of the major contributors of smog, especially because of the timing where it takes place. Because a change in weather at that specific point is what kind of makes the smog stick around. After that, the biggest contributor are vehicular emissions. That is then followed by thermal or industrial power generation emissions. And then comes the brick kilns and industries. And then, as we talked about in the beginning of the video, that once all of these factors kind of form the pollution, then the topography of the area and the weather of the area during that time period kind of makes the smog stick around and doesn't let it go anywhere, which kind of causes long-term effects. So these are some of the reasons as to why smog occurs throughout South Asia and why we're suffering so much. But then comes the case of the city of Lahore. And during my research, I found out that Lahore, unfortunately, is a special case when it comes to smog. And I'll talk more about that in my next video. The aim for this video was to kind of try and understand the reasons as to why this smog occurs and then lingers for so long in this region. And by this time, both the governments of India and Pakistan do take this seriously because smog has real consequences. The onset of smog is followed by large-scale socioeconomic disruptions, traffic accidents and poor health conditions. An estimated 128,000 deaths in Pakistan and 1.2 million deaths in India are linked to smog annually. So it's not something to be taken lightly at all. And I think by this point, everybody in this region realizes that. And there are initiatives taken by both the governments by now to kind of curb this issue. But maybe we'll talk more about that in another video if you guys are interested. And if you like this video, make sure to share it with people, like it, subscribe. It really helps me out. And I will see you guys next time. Bye.